In 2 Kings chapter 2, what we're going to study today, Elisha had recently just taken on the mantle of his predecessor, Elijah. As Paul knew with Timothy, as Jesus understood with his disciples, as Moses understood with Joshua, so too Elijah understood with Elisha that there is no success without a successor. And when Paul the aged was writing to Timothy, when Jesus saw his time was drawing near to go to the cross, when Moses understood that the Israelites were about to pass into the promised land, they saw that just before their death or just before their departure, they were to pass on their mantle, their metaphorical mantle, the proverbial baton, to the next generation to continue to perpetuate the work. And what we have to do, and I talked about this actually on Monday night, is always look down at the next generation and say, how can we reach out to the next generation? See, a lot of people, I hear like older generations say, how can we reach the youth? But I don't care what age you are, we always need to look down at the next generation and say, how can we reach them? You're 8 years old, great, go find a six-year-old and like give them hope. And so we're always wanting to look, if we do this for like all the generations for the rest of history and posterity, the world's gonna change the trajectory and course of history. So Elijah understood this. He's like, okay, I need to perpetuate my yoke. He was riding a heavenly whirlwind, a chariot up to the heavens, and his mantle falls down on Elisha. Elisha picks it up, and he prayed for a double portion of Elijah's spirit. Now, some scholarship actually calculates numerically that Elisha did twice as many miracles as Elijah. He prayed for a double portion of his spirit and he received the answer to his prayer. Some scholars actually suggest numerically he did twice as many miracles. Elisha then takes the mantle of Elijah, goes up to the Jordan River, the same Jordan that the Israelites, 3 million or so of them, had crossed to go into the land of Canaan flowing with milk and honey, that they set up 12 memorial stones representing the 12 tribes. That's why Jesus had 12 disciples to represent the 12 tribes of Israel, that they were passing out of the wilderness. They had wandered around the same mountain for 40 years, should have only taken them 11 days to go from Egypt to Canaan. They pass through the Jordan River, set up memorial stones, go into the land flowing with milk and honey. The river parts in two in the story of Joshua. Now, Elisha seeks to do that same thing. Elisha takes the mantle of his predecessor Elijah, strikes the Jordan River, it parts in two when he cries out in dramatic fashion, where is the God of Elijah? Strikes the river, and in this story, the water parts in two. And Elisha proves that he is indeed the predecessor to the great Elijah. By the way, Elijah showed up on the Mount of Transfiguration along with Moses. Why? Because Elijah in Jewish consciousness represented the greatest prophet. Moses in Jewish consciousness represented the greatest lawgiver. So Jesus was in the center. Why? Because he fulfilled the law and the prophets. Moses, Elijah, the law and the prophets. Jesus was the fulfillment of those. He said, love fulfills the law and the prophets. On this hangs all the law and the prophets. Greater love has no man than this, than that he lays down his life for his friends, which Jesus did on the cross. So Elijah passes on his mantle to Elisha. Now, what's interesting is Elijah, for all of his greatness, was pretty moody. One time he was in a cave. Like he had called down fire, as you know, from a waterlogged like construct wherein he was offering a sacrifice. Do you remember the story? He called down fire. There were 850 prophets of Baal in the groves. And Elijah was able to call down fire, proving that Baal wasn't the true deity of Israel, but Jehovah was. In this story, the fire comes down, burns the waterlogged sacrifice. And there was no water in the land at the time. There was a drought, so the people were probably giving from their own water supply. Sacrifice produces power. And the truth is, you'll never see the harvest in the seed. But if you sacrifice, they were probably sacrificing perhaps their own water supply, and they were drenching the altar when the fire came down upon it. Now, what's also interesting is, as my dad suggests very correctly in the John Courson application commentary, in 1 Kings 18, when Elijah called down fire from heaven, it could be that they, like, where did they get all that water from to soak to soak 12 times for the 12 tribes of Israel, the sacrifice in water, it could very well have been from the Mediterranean Sea, because Mount Carmel overlooks the Mediterranean Sea. The Mediterranean Sea is full of salt water, so they were soaking the construct in salt. Why is that interesting? Because Leviticus 2, watch this, Leviticus 2 says that every sacrifice is to be offered with salt. Every sacrifice is to be offered with salt. Now everyone say salt. This is going to be very important for our text today, salt. Now watch this. Elijah makes it, quote unquote, harder for God to pour down fire from heaven. Nevertheless, God does it, even though it's soaked in water. And he's like exultant in this great victory. He can stare down 850 enemies, and he had no problem with it until one angry woman sent him running. He could stare down 850 prophets of Baal in the groves, but one angry woman sent him running in a chariot. One angry woman named Jezebel unmanned him. And he began running, and actually he outran a chariot. Now, I would love to see this bald prophet girding up his loins, like pulling up his robe, like outrunning Jezebel's chariot. That would have just been quite a funny scene. But Elijah, this old man outrunning the chariot, he ends up in a cave, and Jezebel makes him so depressed, and he's no doubt fatigued after his journey, that he says, I am no better than my fathers. And he asks God, like Job did and like Jonah did when his gourd died because a worm ate it, said, God, take my life. Take my life. Take my life. I love how in these stories, these people are suicidal based on the stupidest things. Like Jonah's suicidal because a worm ate his plant. And Elijah's suicidal because a woman's angry at him. And the truth of the matter is, I think some of these stories might be showing us a little pattern that a lot of times when if you do struggle with suicide, you're not thinking clearly. You're not thinking clearly. C.S. Lewis said, no one can see clearly when his eyes are blurred by tears, both literally and metaphorically. You can't see clearly when your eyes are blurred by tears. Sometimes when we're like, oh, I just want to die, God's like, you are not seeing clearly. Elijah says, and I know it feels real, and I'm not saying there's not real pain, but I'm saying that sometimes we're not seeing things clearly. So God says to Elijah, he says, what are you doing here? Because Elijah's under a juniper tree and in a cave and just sulking in his man cave, his literal man cave. And God says, what are you doing here? And I feel like the Lord says that a lot of times to us when we're sulking in self-pity. He says, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? You're sulking, you're, you know, drawing the blinds, you know, you're turning on some Netflix show, you're like eating ice cream, and you're just like, I want to die. She's mad at me. I want to die. My plants perished under the sun. A worm ate my gourd. God's like, what are you doing here? There's a world out there that needs change. What are you doing here? What are you doing here? What are you doing here in this cave? And that's something I think the Lord might speak to us in these moments of self-pity. What are you doing here? We don't need people's pity. We need the Prince of Peace's power is what we need. So then I love what God proceeds to do in this story. God, he feeds Elijah as angels come and give him food. I love how my pop suggests angel food cake. I don't know what it was, but it must have been delectable. Sweet tooth. The angels feed Elijah. What's more, in the story of 1 Kings, now we're in 1 Kings 19. 1 Kings 19, we see then God himself is taking care of Elijah. Now, why that's so interesting is because when Elijah was strong in faith, a widow sustained him. Remember, he had a prophet's chamber at a widow's house, raised the widow's daughter from the dead in the story. He has a widow's chamber. A widow sustained him. And the Bible says when Elijah was strong in faith doing miracles, ravens were feeding him. Like, how sick would that be? He's like multiplying oil, you know, in the widow's house and raising the Shunammite woman's son from the dead or whatever, like just doing all these miracles. And he's like, God, I'm hungry. God's like, no problem, I got this. And ravens are dropping animal style fries in his mouth. He's just like, this is better than Domino's delivery, like Uber Eats. It's just like ravens dropping food in his mouth. Amazing. Now that's pretty cool. When he's strong in faith, ravens feed him, a widow sustains him. But when he's in his moment of doubt, when he's in his day of deep despair and despond, when he's in this cave, it says that God sustained him and angels fed him. So God kicked up his loving kindness to provision 2.0. Jehovah Jireh kicked up his provision to provision 2.0. Because when Elijah was strong in faith, it says that ravens fed him and a widow sustained him. But when he was doubting and weak in faith, it says that God himself sustained him and angels fed him. It's cool to get fed by winged ravens, but it's even cooler to get fed by winged angels. It's cool to be sustained by a widow, but it's even cooler to be sustained by the one who champions the cause of the widow, God himself.
Come on.
Sometimes God works more through our doubt than through our faith. And he kicks it up to provision 2.0. In the words of Paul, when I'm weak, that's when I'm strong. That's how good he is. It's too good to be true. No, because God's in it. It's so good, it's got to be true. God kicks it up to provision 2.0. Amazing stuff. So Elijah, he recovers from this by eating food, talking to God. And I love how God told him to take a nap. Listen, there are few things in life, there are few problems in life that won't be solved by a power nap, a good meal, and a good prayer time. You know what helps me? Sometimes if I'm having a difficult time talking to God, I'm not trying to like get out of the prayer closet as it were, but like I did this last night, like I was, sometimes it's just hard to talk to God and you just feel tired or whatever. You just take a timer, like I put a timer and I just set it on 15 minutes. I'm like, I can do this. I can talk to him for 15 minutes. You just walk around and talk. Because sometimes you're like, oh, there's the orphans in Gambia and there's the widows in Nigeria and there's the public school system problem, and then there's all these problems and we don't know what to pray. If you're just like, no, I have 15 minutes. I'm just going to talk some stuff over with God. It's really amazing how much it'll heal you. You'll sleep better. Your mind will be clear. It's very amazing. There are very few things in life that a good prayer time, a good meal, friends, and a power nap won't solve. Sometimes it's like, God, I can't riddle out all the existential conundrums that are beyond my psychological constitution, cerebral processes, and gray matter. My 8,600 billion interconnected neurons can never wrap my mind around the difficult problems in life. God's like, take a nap and you'll solve a lot of problems that way. Truly, have you ever found that in life? It's a good principle in 1 Kings 19. So anyway, Elijah recovers from this. Sorry, I didn't plan on covering a bunch of the stories of Elijah, but here we go. Elijah then, remember, rides the whirlwind up to the heavens. The mantle falls down. Elijah says, if you keep your eyes on me when I'm going up to the heavens, the mantle will fall on you. If you collect the mantle, you'll get a double portion of my spirit. Elisha takes the mantle, where's the God of Elijah, strikes the water, passes through the water, comes into Israel, proves he's the prophet, which leaves us in 2 Kings chapter 2. And that brings us to our text. So that was a big, big kind of background to where our text lends us some insight when it comes to Elisha, his predecessor. 2 Kings 2, verse 19. Are you guys there? Do you guys feel like you got some good cliff notes on Elijah and Elisha? Kind of flying 30,000 feet up, just kind of skimming the surface. Then the men of the city, 2 Kings 2:19. So if you've been in church and you're confused, like which one's Elijah and which one's Elisha, remember, Elijah was the first guy. Elisha is his disciple. So now Elisha is on the scene. 2 Kings 2:19. Then the men of the city said to Elisha, please notice, the situation of this city is pleasant as my Lord sees, but the water is bad and the ground barren. And he said, bring me a new bowl and put salt. Everyone say salt in it. So they brought it to him. Then he went out to the source of the water and cast in the salt. Everyone say salt there. So he cast in the salt there and said, thus says the Lord, I have healed. Everyone say healed. This water, from it there shall be no more death or barrenness. So the water, everyone say water, remains healed. Everyone say healed to this day, according to the word of Elisha, which he spoke. So in this story, Elisha has his mettle tested. Does he have what it takes to be the next prophet of Israel? And what Elisha does is he comes to the city of Jericho. It's kind of like the Palm Springs of that time. Good land, beautiful surroundings. Dad, I believe there are palm trees in Jericho. Is that correct? Yes. The great thing when your dad's a Bible scholar, if you don't know something, you can just ask. He's right there in the congregation. So you go to Jericho, man, it's Palm Springs vibe, super nice, super beautiful. He gets there and the people say, oh, we love this city, Jericho, this ancient old city. We love this city. It's beautiful. The surroundings are aesthetically pleasing, but the water is poisoned. The water is mara. It's bitter. And because of this, obviously it would spoil the fruit and it would spoil the vegetation. And it would spoil the crops. We have this pleasant land, but the water's bad. So everything is spoiled. And notice how the water, it says, brought barrenness. The water brought barrenness and death. Because when Elisha heals it, he says, I have healed this water. From it, there shall be no more death or barrenness. No more barrenness or death in the water. What did Jesus say? The Spirit is like torrents of living what? Water that will gush forth. So torrents of living water, not dead water, not barren water, but living water. You got to remember, in the ancient Jewish mind, still water was considered the abyss. That's why, like when John wrote in Revelation, there is no ocean. To him, he's saying there's no abyss anymore. The Jews were not a seafaring people. They didn't like the sea. They thought living water they loved, like trees planted by living waters they love, flowing waters, rivers, geysers. They loved that oasis. They loved that kind of thing. But they hated still water. Still water they thought was the abyss. So when Peter walked out on still water, remember how in Matthew 14 he thought he saw a ghost? Well, of course you'd think you see a ghost. He's in the abyss. There's a storm. He's on still water. Like, of course he's going to think he's seeing a ghost. He's in the abyss. That was how the Jewish mind worked. It's the abyss. So when he was walking on the abyss with Jesus, the abyss was put under his feet, which is super cool. But anyway, the barren water, the dead water in this story would become torrents of living water. No more barrenness, no more death. How? How did Elisha, in this story, this ancient, beautiful Jewish story, how did he heal the waters? He took a bowl of salt, and that's how, watch this, that's how it was healed. Now remember, his master, Elijah, who is like the Yoda to his Obi-Wan Kenobi, or is the Obi-Wan Kenobi to his Anakin, depending on what metaphor you choose, the Gandalf to his Frodo, if you like sci-fi and fantasy. Remember, Elijah, watch this, he poured water on the sacrifice in 1 Kings 18 against the prophets of Baal in the groves. Remember when fire came down? He poured water on the altar. What kind of water was it? Well, if it was from the Mediterranean Sea, which would have been their really only water source unless the people were sacrificing their own supply, was filled with salt. The Mediterranean Sea water was filled with salt. So when he put salt water on the sacrifice, the salt water brought about the healing of the nation of Israel when they recognized Jehovah was God and not this weird fertility god Baal, who was a bizarre god and son of Dagon. So just as the healing waters, the salt water of the Mediterranean, healed the Israelites spiritually, in Elijah's day, when the salt water from the Mediterranean Sea, Leviticus 2, every sacrifice is to be seasoned with salt. When the sacrifice on the altar was soaked in salt water, the Mediterranean Sea, on Mount Carmel. So too, Elisha takes salt, pours it in the water, makes it salt water, and that's how he brings about the physical healing of Jericho. I hope you guys caught that just now, because I'm not going over that again, because we got to keep moving. But basically, it was in the salt that the healing came. It was in the salt that the healing came. Why? Well, salt to this day continues to heal. As you know, salt helps heal wounds. When you go into a salt ocean, it helps. It hurts, but it heals your wounds, right? Salt, as you know, heals food. It's a preservative that wards off the second law of thermodynamics, decay, putrefaction, wards off decay, keeps decay at bay, wards off putrefaction. Salt, as you know, lends flavor to things. Do you know how gross food would be without salt? It would be insipid, even disgusting. If you look at ingredients, most foods have salt. If you have no salt, a lot of food would be very gross. So salt lends flavor to life. Salt brought healing to the waters of Jericho. The people of Jericho are rejoicing because Elisha took a bowl of salt, poured it in the waters of Jericho. Suddenly it's healed. He proves he is the next prophet of Israel. And Jesus jumps on this idea when in Matthew 5:13, and also I believe in the book of Luke, he said, you are the salt of the earth and every sacrifice is seasoned with salt, according to Leviticus 2, Jesus taught. Now watch. You are the salt of the earth. Now we've went over a lot of Bible stuff, history, but how does this apply to our life? Now watch. You, Jesus said in Matthew 5:13, are the salt of the earth. We were meant to be the healing balm of Gilead, the healing salt to the abyss, to the waters of this world. The earth to this day spiritually seems formless and void, without form and void. We as the salt in the water will bring healing to the void, to the abyss, just as the Jews believed that still water was an abyss, and we will create torrents of living water, which do not bring barrenness and death, but living water, life, and rebirth, the second birth, born again. We, my friends, are the salt of the earth that bring healing to the nations. Turn with me to Romans 12, verse 2, to see what this looks like. Romans 12, verse 2, and it looks like we're on time. You guys doing okay so far? Okay. Romans 12, 2. And while you turn there, speaking of water, all this talking about water is making me thirsty. So let's not just be hearers, let's be doers of the word. Thank you, Father, for healing waters. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Oh, this is fun. I love this. I love this. I love what I do. Like, I love getting to do what I do. It's just such a blessing, getting to share with you these healing texts. Romans 12, 2, watch this. And do not be, are you guys there? You should be there, because I got a water break. Are you there? Okay. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Do not be conformed to this world. Do not be conformed to this world. Do not be conformed to this world. Don't let the world happen to you. You happen to the world. So often, it breaks my heart. The church as a whole, and I am the chief of sinners here, we look at the world around us and we complain. We say, look at how dirty the waters are. Look at this abyss without form and void. And we just are like cursing the barrenness of the waters of this world. We're like, it's horrible. But Jesus said, be salt in this earth. Be the salt that brings healing rather than the curse that brings constant criticism on it. Don't be conformed to the world. Instead of criticizing the world or even conforming to it and just saying, well, if you can't beat them, join them. Be the salt in this world and bring healing. Bring healing. Bring healing. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. When you understand that you are salt, suddenly you're lending flavor to life. You're bringing healing to the world. You are keeping spiritual decay at bay. We've been called to be the salt in this earth. What does that mean? Very simply, it means we are the agents of change. Now, watch this. If like food goes bad, I don't just blame the food. I blame the salt for not doing its job. Whoever didn't pour salt on this food, like they didn't have refrigerators in the ancient world, so you poured salt on food to keep it from going bad. I'm not going to blame the meat for going bad. That's the very nature of the meat. It's going to go bad. I'd blame the person for not pouring the salt on it. And so too, we need to look at the world and say, if it's going bad, it's not just the world's fault. That means we need to do our job and say, okay, if the world is going bad, rather than complaining about it or being conformed to it, we need to be the healing salt. We need to be agents of change in this world, not being conformed to the world, but transformed by the renewing of our mind. Are you guys tracking with me? Because I'm really, really trying to see if you guys are getting this. We don't want to let the world happen to us. We happen to the world. How? By being transformed by the renewing of our mind. It all starts up here, the mind. You're transformed by the renewing of your mind. Right now, I've been thinking about this verse, Ecclesiastes 11:10. Therefore, remove sorrow from your heart. Therefore, remove sorrow from your heart. I've been thinking about this. What is causing our generation to fall into putrefaction and decay? Why is our generation, the world today, without form and void? It's just waters that are barren and lifeless. What's going on? I want to tell you just from a millennial's perspective in traveling, what I've seen happening to our generation. The past few weeks have been really cool just watching God open up doors for me to get to speak this message on a more national platform, just getting to be on ABC Family and Freeform and the Hallmark Channel and the 700 Club and just going on national media, getting to talk about some of this stuff. And Harvest last week at my friend Greg Laurie's church and like really addressing some of these issues. The number one thing I'm asked all the time, there's two things I'm constantly asked about my generation. They're constantly asking, what's going on with social media? Why has it addicted your generation? And number two, they asked, why are you guys so depressed? At this point in my life, and I'm very clear about this, I'm not gonna say, you know, our generation's actually very happy, because it's not. There are a lot of joyful people. There's a lot of salt here, of course. The truth of the matter is we are the most depressed generation ever. There's zero question about it. In fact, listen to some of these stats. This will blow your mind. Listen to what's happening today. I believe depression is the hot button issue. Like that is the big issue of our day. Depression is the hot button issue of our time. I don't know if for those of you baby boomers in the hippie movement, it might've been like LSD. I don't know what your hot button issue was, or the Vietnam War. What ours is depression. Depression and social media, that is the hot button issue of our time. Let me just read you some stats. Did you know that social media is now listed by the Center for Disease Control to be the number one issue for health? Why are the water sick? Well, that is insane. According to the Center for Disease Control, social media is the number one issue for health? So people are trying to cure HIV. They're trying to cure AIDS. Great. We also need to cure social media, which is now a disease. Amazing. According to the Center for Disease Control, it's number one when it comes to health issues. Number two is STDs. 50% of all STDs are among 15 to 24-year-olds. And number three is obesity. Listen, Americans spend up to five... Watch this. Guys, this is... If you are not seeing this, I love you, but you are blind to this issue. Really open your eyes to this. Americans spend up to 5 hours a day on their phones. How much is that? Well, that adds up to 150 hours a month. How much of that? 14 years in a lifetime. And that's not including sleep. 14 years of your lifetime is spent on this little device. 14 years. Why are people addicted? Very simple. We get the same dopamine response from likes, texts, notifications, and emails as we do from gambling. When you gamble, I've never gambled, but I assume this is how it works. When you go into a casino, you gamble and you don't know whether you're gonna win or lose, and that's the thrill. When your phone goes, vroom, vroom, you know that sound? Vroom, vroom, you don't know, is it a good text, a bad text? Is it a good comment? And it's addicting like gambling, so you just have to, your dopamine response is the same as gambling. So you have to see what's happening. So now that we spend so much time on social media and virtual reality that we can't parse out fiction from actual reality, we spend about $250 billion a year on prescription drugs. 1 in 10 people are on antidepressants at any given time. More like 1 in 4 over a lifetime. Mental illness is exploding. The waters are barren. We have beautiful surroundings. We live better than kings used to live. The economy is booming. It's not 2008 anymore. The market isn't crashed. We don't have to short the housing market anymore. Everything's beautiful except the waters are barren. We're depressed. Where are these torrents of living water, the spirit whose fruit is joy? The fruit is bitter. It's not there. It's barren. It's lifeless. What's going on? What do we do? Look down 10 verses at Romans 12, 12. How are we transformed by the renewing of our mind? Not conformed to the world, not engaging in the barrenness and death of the world, but rather being transformed by the renewing of our mind and being healing waters, healing salt, pardon me, in its waters. Look at this. Romans 12, 12. There is hope, my friends. I got to tell you the sickness so I can also share the cure. Are you guys doing okay? Okay. Romans 12, 12. Rejoicing in hope. Everyone say rejoicing in hope. Patient in tribulation. Everyone say patient in tribulation. Continuing instant in prayer. Everyone say continuing instant in prayer. Another translation renders this verse, let this hope burst forth within you, releasing a continual joy. Don't give up in a time of trouble, but commune with God at all times. Okay, so let's break this down. Number one, rejoicing in hope. Why is social media causing depression? because that's one of the chief causes for sickness and depression. It's very simple. It was meant to connect us, but what initially was meant to connect us becomes comparison, and we compare ourselves. We all know that. One of the things I like to do is just realize, okay, I might get in trouble for this, but let's just take a quick chug of water and see what happens. Let's just see what happens here. The Second Amendment, okay? Hold on, just the gun laws. Let me talk about this. I'm remaining bipartisan. Wherever you land on the gun issue, and I'm going to remain totally bipartisan here, but wherever you land on the gun issue, the fact of the matter is the guns are out there. It's like, what are you going to do? Like, give the government back all the guns? Like, they're out there. People can hide their guns. So whatever you think on the gun issue, whether we should or shouldn't have guns, whatever, I'm not here to talk about politics, but I will say this. The guns are out there. It's like, they're out there. The cat's out of the bag. Pandora's box has been opened, so we have to figure out what to do about it. There's a lot of gun deaths in our country. Okay, whatever you think about the issue. Social media is like the Second Amendment. It's out there. Like, what's Zuckerberg gonna do? Take it all back? No, it's out there. Everybody in my age group's on it. Now, you're like, I know somebody in Missouri, my second cousin, who's not on it. I'm sure there are people out there who are not on it. I don't know many, but it's like the modern equivalent of a hermit, which is great. Like, John the Baptist was something of a hermit. He was an ascetic. But social media, like guns, it's like, oh, wow, guns are bad for us, but they're out there. So, too, social media is bad for us. We all know that now. It's like, okay, and now all science is saying social media is bad for us. Now they're just trying to say, please limit it to 2 hours a day so it doesn't do permanent damage to your brain. But it's like, shoot, it's out there. What do we do? It's out there. Here's the best solution I have right now. Even if you are in social media, my age group, maybe there will be a mass exodus. That'd be sick. But even if you're engaged in social media, remember this. Social media is just a virtual form of the world. And Jesus said, you are not of the world, but you are in the world. One of the things I literally like to do is I delete my app. My team has a thing going where we post every day, and every day we'll post something hopefully beneficial, something that will help other people. But I delete my app for several days at a time. Like, and then I'll re-upload it, post some stuff myself, then delete it so I can't just keep getting addicted. You know your ghost finger? Like, you're waiting in a drive-thru, and what do you immediately do? And then you're like, oh, my app's deleted. So your finger's going to nothing because you're like, you've trained subconsciously your finger to go to the app. Delete the app, say, you know what? I can survive without it for a couple days, and then go back on it and infiltrate it, not isolate necessarily, but infiltrate it with hope and say, how can I use social media not just to impress people, but to impact people? How can I not be conformed to the world, but transformed by the renewing of my mind and be salt in the barrenness and death of social media to bring life, to take away comparison, to create connection, to not just impress, but to impact, to not bring hurt, but to bring hope, and being in it, but not of it. Are you tracking with me? Now, how can we do this? How can we do this? Did I say anything too bad about the second law, or are we good? Okay, we're solid. Okay. Because I didn't say anything one way or the other. I'm just like, they're out there. Everyone knows they're out there. Raise of hands. How many of you have guns? No, I'm joking. Don't raise your hand. Joking. That was a joke. That was a joke. Okay. Hey, nobody glare at me. I didn't say one way or the other. How do we do this? Well, look at what verse 12 says. Number one, like, how do we be healing salt in the barrenness and death of our generation? How do we be the salt of the earth? How can we bring about healing like the prophet Elisha? How can we be like salt on the altar of Elijah on Mount Carmel? Salt, salt, salt. Number one, remember, salt brings flavor to life. We need to bring flavor to life again. Winston Churchill, his last words when he died were, I'm bored of it all. Eventually you go on social media, you're like, I'm bored of it all. It's all the same thing over and over again, okay? Now, it can be good. It can connect us when it's put in its right place. But watch this. Look at what Paul says. Don't be conformed to the world. Okay, how can we transform it? Not let the world happen to us, but happen to the world. Verse 12, he says, rejoicing in hope. Everyone say rejoicing in hope. I love that word rejoicing. Everyone say rejoice. Rejoice. Did you know the shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept, is only the shortest verse in the Bible in the English translation? But the Bible was not originally written in English. The shortest verse in the Bible is actually rejoice always. When Paul commanded rejoice always, that's 14 characters in the Greek language. Jesus wept is 16 characters in the Greek language. So originally, the shortest verse in the original manuscripts of the Bible is rejoice always. So weeping does not have the first word, rejoicing does. Rejoice always. You may sow in tears, but you will reap in joy. Weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Rejoice always. 14 characters in the Greek language. It's actually originally the shortest verse. And if a pithy, powerful punch is packed by brevity, then this is the wit of genius. Rejoice always. Number one, rejoice in what? Hope. Let your hopes, not your hurts, shape your future. Hurt people, hurt people. We want to go into social media or wherever we are in the world, and we want to help people, not letting our hurts but our hopes shape the future. We say, we're going to bring hope to the barrenness and death of our generation. This is interesting. Rejoicing in hope. When's the last time you woke up in the morning and your feet hit the ground and you have your tousled bedhead or whatever? And you're like, I am pumped. And your kid's like, why are you pumped? I'm rejoicing. What are you rejoicing in? I'm rejoicing in hope. Like, I am rejoicing in hope. When's the last time you did that? You're like, I'm rejoicing in hope. This generation is so depressed, but I am rejoicing in hope. They're like, really? You're not just rejoicing, but you're rejoicing in hope. That's what Paul says in our text. Rejoicing in hope. Paul says, we have this hope, therefore we are very bold. Or the author of Hebrews says, whoever wrote it. We have this hope, therefore we are very bold. This hope is an anchor for the soul. In thy word do I hope. I have a joy that no man could take from me, Jesus said. So I'm going to be rejoicing in hope. I am not conformed to the barrenness and death of this world. I am the salt in this world. I'm not being changed by the world. I'm the agent of change in this world. I'm not the barren waters. I'm the salt of the earth. So I get to bring healing to the nations. I am so pumped, little junior. I'm rejoicing in hope. I've never met someone I'm like, man, they just have too much joy. Man, they're too hopeful. No, we need more people who are going to be rejoicing in hope. We don't need the frozen chosen. We need some more people rejoicing in hope. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Do we have some alive people here today? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Rejoicing in hope. I love this. You're like, oh, Ben, but I got giants in the promised land. Oh, I know Joshua crossed the Jordan and Elisha crossed the Jordan with the mantle, but there are giants here. Did you know the giants kept out the children of Israel from the promised land, except for Joshua and Caleb? Why? Because they were scared of giants. But the funny thing is, if you do the math, the Israelites did not get attacked by a giant for 374 years. And even when that happened, a 15-year-old killed him with a rock. What's keeping you out of your promised land? What's keeping you out of the land flowing from milk and honey? What's keeping you from grabbing your mantle, striking the waters, and saying, ah, the Lord has given us bread, the promised land? That's what the giants are to us. By the way, Caleb attacked a giant, but they didn't attack him. He went on the offense and attacked them. The Israelites didn't even get attacked by a giant for 374 years. And even then, a 15-year-old killed him with a rock. When you rejoice, and I'm going to draw to a close here. It's 11:04. I'm almost done. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. The Bible says, in everything, give thanks. Everyone say, in everything, give thanks. Shortest verse in the Bible, 14 characters, rejoice always. In everything, give thanks. According to a study, people who are generally more grateful, gave more money to a cause, showed greater neural sensitivity in the medial prefrontal cortex, the brain area associated with learning and decision-making. In the story of the 10 lepers, one person who was healed turned to give thanks to Jesus, proskuneo, to kiss the king in worship. And Jesus said, where are the nine? Where are the nine? Only one turned back to give thanks. Faith is to put all your eggs in God's basket, then count your blessings before they hatch. Give thanks. Listen, our generation is depressed, but it's going to go from a mope generation to a hope generation. If it's the last thing I do, I am going to, with my dying breath, fight for this generation to change. Like, if we're on this mote of dust hurtling through a sunbeam at 67,000 miles per hour, we might as well change it while we're here. So I'm going to give thanks ahead of time that young men will see visions. I'm going to give thanks ahead of time that old men are going to dream dreams. I'm going to give thanks ahead of time that the Spirit of God is going to fall on all flesh. I'm going to give thanks ahead of time that there's going to be a spiritual awakening. And I'm going to give thanks ahead of time that we're going to go from a mope generation to a hope generation, because if it's the last thing I do, even if I have to stutter to get it out. We're going to be the salt healing our generation. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
We're here to heal. We're here to heal. Every morning when you wake up, say, I'm here to heal. Everyone say, I'm here to heal.
I'm here to heal.
Oh, how our generation, I can see it. I have vision for this thing. I can see it. If all of us woke up in the morning and we said, I'm here to heal. I'm salt. I'm salt. I'm salt. I'm here to heal. How this generation would change. Wow. How this generation would change. Number two, give me like 3 more minutes then I'm done. Whew, that was fun. Patient in tribulation. Everyone say, patient in tribulation. How are we not conformed to the world? We're rejoicing in hope, lending salt to the earth, flavor, healing. Number two, patient in tribulation. Patient in tribulation. You say, Ben, I feel like Elijah in that cave. I'm depressed. I feel like Elisha. I could never fill the shoes of Elijah. I feel like I could never possibly, I feel like I can never possibly heal all the death and barrenness around me. What do you do when you're going through your own personal tribulation? Well, remain patient in tribulation. In Israel, a few months ago, our tour guide told me something very interesting. She said the word patience in Hebrew is the word savlanut. Everyone say savlanut. The word in Hebrew, the root is savel. Everyone say savel. The root means suffering. So patient and suffering comes from the same root word. Patience is savlanut in Hebrew. The word is savel, which means suffering. In other words, whenever you're suffering, what's your automatic response? Patience. 106 times, the Bible says, wait on the Lord. If you're in pain, don't panic. Have patience. It will pass. Patient in tribulation. Just say, you know what? This is awful right now, but I'm just going to wait. I'm going to throw this salt in and let's just see what happens. Patient in tribulation. And then lastly, continuing instant in prayer. This is the last thing. Constantly praying. Constantly praying. Guys, all through the day, constantly get healing from Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals, and you'll be a healing agent for the barrenness and death in our generation, the world without form and void, these waters. And you'll cast into those waters and you'll mend as a panacea, nepenthe, a fruit of life. Listen, continuing instant in prayer. Did you know? I actually came across this a few weeks ago in a study. Did you know that talking to God about your hopes, your fears, and your dreams has the same effect on your brain as therapy? And it's free. And there's no Oedipus complex, daddy issues, Freudian slips, psychodrama, subconscious where the orc dungeon where goblins make swords, a strange ocean where dark things swim. No, it's just like you talk, nothing wrong with psychiatry when it's done the right way, which is, well, let's keep going. Truly, I'm not saying one way or the other, but I will say this. When you pray, when you talk intentionally to God about your hopes, rejoicing in hope, your fears, the most repeated commandment, do not fear, and your dreams, old men dreaming dreams, young men seeing visions, I've not been disobedient to the heavenly vision, Paul said. When you're talking to God constantly about these things, it has the same effect on your brain as therapy. Literally, you walk away like you just went to a counselor. What does Isaiah say? He is the everlasting Father, the wonderful counselor. Have you ever been to a bad counselor? No? Okay, well, it's an experience. And when you go to a counselor, and you're like, dude, you're quoting me the textbook. I know more than you on this very issue you're talking to me about. You walk away, you're like, that was not a wonderful experience. But when you walk away from God, you're like, walk away from a prayer time with God, you're like, wonderful counsel. Wonderful counsel. Wonderful counselor. And when you pray to a loving God, watch this. The prefrontal lobe of your brain activates into its highest intellectual capacity and you boost your brain intelligence by praying. Who knew? God did. You actually get smarter by praying. That's why Solomon, he could pray, God, give me wisdom. And then two prostitutes come to him and say, this baby's mine. Another prostitute says, no, this baby's mine. And they're both saying the same baby is theirs. And what does Solomon do? He says, take out a sword and chop the baby in two. Wonderful counsel. You say, how is that wonderful counsel? Because the fake mother said, yes, give her half the baby, give me half the baby. But the real mother said, give the entire baby to the false mother. I would rather have the baby with the false mother than have the baby die, split in two. Where did Solomon get this counsel, this wisdom? He prayed. He said, Father, give me an understanding heart. When you pray, when you're instant in prayer, you have wonderful counsel how to solve these complex, infinitely intricate issues of our day when you're instant in prayer. So, my friends, let's go heal this thing. Let's go do it. I just believe we're on the cusp of seeing something. We are. This generation's about to change. Listen, is it barren? Is it lifeless? Yes, but there's a lot of salt that's about to be thrown into the waters without form and void, and a new creation is going to burst forth.